Guitar players know how great Mike Campbell is. We know those classic Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers songs wouldn't be the same without him. That band was a partnership, many times a collective of songwriters, and they all had input and crafted those songs into what they came to be. And Mike was co-captain of that ship. I'm going to play you some of my favorite Mike Campbell riffs. We're going to look at Mike playing. We're going to listen to some great music, and we're going to celebrate Mike Campbell in this video. In the 1960s, if you were an aspiring guitar player, Central Florida was a good place to be. In Daytona Beach, you had the Allman Brothers, and over in Gainesville, you had Don Felder, who would later become an Eagle, and Stephen Stills from Buffalo Springfield and Crosby, Stills, and Nash. Also in 1970 from Gainesville, there was a startup band called Mudcrutch. Mudcrutch would eventually become Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. They moved to California and got a record deal. Eventually, Mudcrutch got dropped, but they wanted to keep Tom Petty on because they knew he was a great songwriter. Tom Petty kept most of his bandmates from Mudcrutch, and they got a new name and started writing hits. Their first album had American Girl and Breakdown, and they were off and running. Mike was always on the cutting edge of technology. Anytime a new device or effect came out, you would pretty quickly hear it on the Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers records, if it was worth a damn. Going into the 1980s, the band were incredibly tight, and they went into the studio to record Damn the Torpedoes. These were grueling sessions by all accounts, but the band became studio masters. Just the drum sounds are stuff of legend. Working with Shelly Yackas, the band got these huge drums that we'd never heard before. In the early 1980s, Mike was tight with a man named Roger Lynn. Roger was developing a new technology that would take over the sound of 1980s music. Mike was doing a demo called Boys of Summer, which Tom Petty ended up not doing. It eventually made its way to Don Henley, and it's one of the first times we heard a Lynn drum. The Lynn drum very quickly became the sound of rock and roll and pop music. Take a minute to talk to you about the channel. In the month of December, I had more views than in any other month since I've been on YouTube. I've been watching this momentum slowly build, and it's making me happy that people are finally starting to see these videos and react to them. It has taken me a bit of time to figure out the algorithm. As long as I'm doing videos on legendary guitar players or guitar gear or studio videos like my top 5 plugins, all these videos are doing well. The minute I stray from that, the algorithm shoots down my videos and to some extent shoots down the momentum that I have rolling on the other videos. I had that happen this month when I released a song. YouTube didn't let anybody see it and it just shut everything down. So we're building back a little bit, and anything you can do to help us out, like, subscribe, leave a comment. If you like these type of videos, this is what I love to do. I also like to make music here, but it's going up on other platforms. And we're going to keep this about the guitar legends and studio tips. And like, subscribe, leave me a comment, and we'll keep them coming out. It's important to understand just how valuable Mike Campbell was to Tom Petty's songwriting process. Tom had 2 successful careers, both with the Heartbreakers and solo. His solo career was just as successful as anything he did with the Heartbreakers. So in the late 80s, when he decided to do his first solo record, the cast all changed. Jeff Lynne from ELO came on as a producer. Jim Keltner and Ringo were on drums. But Mike Campbell remained. Also, Benmont was a part of these solo records. Beginning in the early 80s, Tom Petty was at war with his record company. They wanted to raise the price of his records from $8.98 to $9.98, and Tom thought it was price gouging. He just wanted to get his music out there and have people not go broke getting it. He knew what it was like to not have a lot, and he fought for his music. He always did. So he didn't want to record or put out any more music for his label, and they eventually let him out of his contract under the contingency that he put out one more greatest hits LP with 2 new songs. Before Tom went to Warner Brothers, he wanted to get these 2 songs knocked out, and he had Rick Rubin on board to help him with his solo album. Rick was going to produce this new album, Wildflowers, and Tom had him listen to some cuts that they had been demoing to see if he thought there was anything usable for the 2 songs for the greatest hits record. Rick didn't hear much that stood out on those demo cuts, but in between 2 of the songs, Mike was noodling, and he played a figure that Rick thought had potential. He brought the demo tape back to the boys and played the little snippet for them. That little noodling lick that Mike did became Last Dance with Mary Jane. It's crazy when you think about songwriting, how things that you might not have think have potential or can build upon can turn into something great. This is especially true if you have a platform like Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers did. This was supposed to be a throwaway album, just greatest hits to get off the record label, finish this one thing up, and on to the next thing. And Mike was just noodling that lick, wasn't even thinking about it, and it became one of the biggest songs they ever had. Having a YouTube channel has shown me that most viewers have a short attention span, so I like to keep these videos around 10 or 12 minutes. And I think we're about there with the clips of Mike, but I do want to highlight some of his more recent projects. And his social media posting since COVID has gotten very interesting. Of course, we were all extremely sad when Tom passed away, none of us more than Mike. but he went on to join Fleetwood Mac. While he was in Fleetwood Mac, he was getting with the vocal coach. Then he started his own band, The Dirty Knobs. They've been touring extensively since COVID ended. Also, while COVID was going on heavy and everybody was locked down, Mike was posting from the Heartbreakers Clubhouse and from his own home, talking about those classic songs and songs he wrote, the guitars he used, gear he used, amplifiers, different styles of playing. It's all very interesting. If you're a guitar player or just love music, go check out Mike's YouTube channel and go back and look at those old posts. Also, Gibson TV on YouTube did a collection episode featuring Mike's guitar collection. It's a great episode. It looks a lot at a lot of these old guitars he used to make those hit records. And I've also heard it said that Gibson, the Gibson Garage in Nashville, where they have the revolving elevated guitar system to display the guitars, Mike has something very similar in his home. And I heard that Gibson got the idea for that from Mike. I don't have any proof of that, but it looks like a similar system, and Mike's had his for a while. So check out Mike Campbell. I love him. It's music I grew up on. He's in my top three favorite guitar players. I think Mike Campbell's one of the most underrated guitar players. Most guitar players love him, but what I mean by underrated is when you talk about songwriters, you hear teams like Lennon McCartney, Jagger Richards, Steven Tyler, and Joe Perry. But when you hear Tom Petty, that's usually all you hear. It should be Petty and Campbell. So, dig deep into Mike Campbell. There's a wealth of knowledge there and some great licks. Check him out. This has been a fun video to make about one of my favorite musicians ever.